In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God,
have mercy on us.
We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin.
We are truly sorry and humbly repent.
In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown,
things we have done and things we have failed to do.
Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin, and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with the power of the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith.
Amen.
We sing as our gathering hymn number 532, Gather Us In.
Thank you.
But yes, in the past, too young to mow the grass, okay? That's all? I'm thinking about, how about when we would want to go on roller coasters before and you weren't tall enough, right? But now you are tall enough to ride a lot more of the roller coasters, right? And you've probably been told by other people that you weren't old enough to drive a car yet, right? That's not my rule, that's just the rule, right? How does it feel when somebody tells you, whether it's me or a teacher or somebody else, that you're too young for something? Okay. It makes you feel good or bad? Disappointed. Yeah, that's a good word. Yeah. Sometimes it feels like when somebody tells you you're too young for something, it's almost like they're saying you don't matter until you're older, right? And I know nobody means that. Sometimes it feels like that. It feels like the people who really matter are the people who are old enough to drive cars, the people who are old enough to vote, the people who are old enough to have jobs and bank accounts and money. And sometimes it feels like the world sends us a whole bunch of messages when we're younger that you don't count because you're too young. I bring good news to you today, Mark, and for anybody else who happens to be overhearing us as well. What's that? It's not time for a car yet, you know.
Lawnmower.
We'll start with lawnmower. Something with the motor. But your belonging in God's family isn't about how old you are. And God says that the people who matter aren't the people who are old enough to have jobs or money or power or things like that, but that God intentionally welcomes all of us, even when everybody else says, you're too young to be important, you're too young to matter. We're going to hear a story in just a little bit where Jesus borrowed a little child, like maybe like a preschool age kid, and says to his closest followers, I want you to welcome children like this in my name. Children like that, my goodness, they can't do anything for the family, right? They can't have a job and make money. They can't help with chores. They can't do the dishes. But Jesus says, even when you don't bring anything into the household, even when you don't have a cash value that way, you still belong in God's family. And on the days when I'm feeling like, man, I don't contribute much, it helps me to remember that my belonging in God's family isn't about what I've done or earned or how old enough or tall enough or anything else I am, but that God just welcomes me in the family because the party wouldn't be the same without me. And if there's ever a time when you feel like the world keeps telling you you're too young for something, I want you to remember, and tell somebody else who might need to know too, that God welcomes you just as you are, and God isn't looking to get something out of you, but God just wants you to belong because the party wouldn't be the same without you. Fair enough? I'm glad. How about, can we pray right where we are? Anybody else, right where you are, you can pray with us too. Good Lord, there are lots of times when other voices tell us or make us feel like we don't matter because either we're not old enough or we don't make enough money or we don't have enough status. There's lots of ways we feel like we don't matter or don't count. But you have a way of breaking down all those barriers and telling us that even when we're very, very young or like young children don't bring in income to the family or have jobs or all sorts of grown-up things, that you welcome us just as we are too. Help us to trust that that love calls us your children, your sons and daughters, part of your family already, even right now. And help us to share that news with somebody else who might feel like they don't belong. Thank you for your love, Jesus. We love you too. Amen. Thanks, Mark.
I have committed my cause. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm for today is Psalm 54, printed on the left and middle column of our bulletin. I'll invite you to follow along reading the bold verses as I read the regular type. Save me, O God, by your name. In your might, defend my cause.
Hear my prayer, O God. You give ear to the words of my mouth.
For strangers have risen up against me, and the ruthless have sought my life, those who have no regard for God.
Behold, God is my helper. It is the Lord who sustains my life.
Render evil to those who spy on me, and your faithfulness destroy them.
I will offer you a freewill sacrifice, and praise your name, O Lord, for it is good.
For you have rescued me from every trouble, and my eye looks down on my enemies.
Our second reading comes from the book of James, the third chapter. Who is wise and understanding among you? Show by your good life that your works are done with gentleness born of wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not be boastful and false to the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from above, but it is earthly, unspiritual, and devilish. For where there is envy and selfish ambition, there will also be disorder and wickedness of every kind. But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without a trace of partiality or hypocrisy. And a harvest of righteousness is sown in peace for those who make peace. Those conflicts and disputes among you, where do they come from? Do they not come from your cravings that are at war within you? You want something and do not have it, so you commit murder. And you covet something and cannot obtain it, so you engage in disputes and conflicts. You do not have because you do not ask. You ask and you do not receive because you ask wrongly in order to spend what you get on your own pleasures. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Draw near to God and he will draw near to you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him, and 3 days after being killed he will rise again. But they did not understand what he was saying, and were afraid to ask him. Then they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the way?" But they were silent, for on the way they had argued with one another about who was the greatest. He sat down, called the 12, and said to them, "Whoever wants to be first must be last of all and servant of all." Then he took a little child and put it among them. And taking it in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
The congregation will be seated. So let me ask you, what was your closest brush with greatness in life? who would be the person, the most important, the closest thing to a celebrity you have ever rubbed elbows with? Who might you say is the most important or influential person you've ever been in the same room with, or, dare I suggest it, gotten to have a conversation with? I suspect we all have a story about the time that you got to meet so-and-so, fill in the blank, and I also have a hunch that the way you answer that question, who's the greatest person you've ever been in the same room with, says an awful lot about the assumptions each of us makes about who counts as great. When I was younger, I had different ready-made answers for that question. Because the question of who's the most famous person or most important person you've ever been in the same room with, or what's your closest brush with greatness, that's the sort of thing that comes up in small talk, or in times when you want to flex a little and impress people with the big names that you know, the people that you have influence with, or maybe people you have a little pull with. These are the kind of stories we trot out in those kind of situations when you're looking to burnish your own reputation, right? So, when I was in high school once, you may have heard me tell this, not to brag again, but when I was in high school once, I got to share an elevator with 1980s Cleveland Browns quarterback Bernie Kosar. That's right, Bernie Kosar. It was all of a minute long, after all, and I must confess to you, I didn't do anything but stand there awkwardly as he entered the elevator. It barely registered, oh my goodness, that's Bernie Kosar, and then he said to everybody else staring in the elevator, "We all Browns fans in here?" He went up to his floor, and that was the end of that. So for a while, that was my story of my celebrity sighting. I shared an elevator. I breathed the same air as before COVID. I breathed the same air as Bernie Kosar. Now, that story plays better in Northeast Ohio, where I grew up. It does not mean nearly as much as I might have thought it did in Western Pennsylvania, where everybody goes to Browns. They're barely professional. Then there was a time when I was in seminary when my go-to response for stories like this was, one time I gave a ride from the airport to hymn writer Marty Howgan. Oh my goodness, that's a name many people don't know, but if you liked our opening hymn, Gather Us In, guess who wrote that? Marty Howgan. That's right. And he once was in the back of my 1997 Dodge Intrepid. It's true. It just so happens that the music director at the seminary needed someone to pick him up because he was coming to give a workshop, and I met all the requirements. I owned a car and was free at the time that his flight was coming in. But for a while, my go-to was, that guy who wrote that song we like every so often in church. I picked him up from the airport once. Come on now. Not too long ago, a couple of years ago, my go-to reference would have changed too, and I would have bragged about how a well-known, well-published author once liked a tweet I put up on social media and then followed me on social media, and my goodness, I was so full of pride that day. That well-known author, she followed me, of all the people, no, she follows 1,000 people, but I'm one of them too. We all have stories like that. I suspect yours are more exciting than mine. The bar is pretty low for even my stories of celebrity sighting, but there is something that I think is like intrinsically human about having those kind of stories to pull out. Because even if we don't say it out loud, I think our default assumption, our conventional wisdom, is that when you're in the company of people that everybody regards as great in whatever way they are regarded as great, some of that rubs off on you too. That their prestige becomes yours because you were in their company. Especially if you had words with them, you're important enough to have been in a conversation with somebody very, very important. Well, then you must be important too. We have a way then of kind of self-selecting, wanting to be in places where the so-and-sos will be, where the important people, whether they're the politically well-connected or the celebrity or the well-known or people who have pull or influence in things that will help you out, or the wealthy. It's so easy to slide into, well, who will be at that gathering? If it's somebody important, I will be there. If there's nobody important, then I can't make the time. I've got other things to do. It is so easy for us to slide into that because conventional wisdom is when you're associated with, the great people, then some of that greatness becomes yours too. And you want to create moments where great people gather, after all. Jesus has a way, as he always does, though, of forcing us to re-examine who counts as great. And like I say, how you answer the question, who's the greatest person you've ever been in the same room with, how you answer that question says an awful lot about who you and I think are great. Or maybe even what the definition of greatness is. And Jesus, over and over and over again, seems to be in the business of redefining words we thought we knew. We noticed that probably even last week. Last week, we reached about the middle point of Mark's gospel, which is sort of a turning point, a fulcrum in the story. And at that point, we saw last week, Jesus tells his disciples, he asks them, well, who do you say that I am? What do you think? What do other people say? And at that point, they're all thinking, Jesus, you're getting me well known as a healer and a teacher. You're a well-respected rabbi. And then Peter blurts out the thing. He is sure, is certain. He says, you're the Messiah. So he's thinking, not only are you a well-respected religious teacher, not only do you have miraculous powers to heal, but you're going to be King Jesus, you're going to raise up an army, maybe even angel armies, and you're going to overthrow the Romans. You'll be the most important person in the world. And we 12 who got in on the ground floor here in Galilee, we're all going to be your executive vice presidents of different stuff, and we'll be great because we'll ride your coattails. You're the Messiah, Jesus, Peter said last week. Sort of the unspoken, and that means I'm great too. Jesus blew that apart. Because after Peter says, you're the Messiah, Jesus goes, okay, but that word doesn't mean what you think it means. I'm going the way of suffering love. My way of being God's Savior is the path of self-giving, suffering love, where the respectable religious people will reject me and the politically powerful people will kill me, not that I'll be the king of the world commanding armies with wealth and power and glory. That blew the disciples' mind. And a chapter later, their minds are still blown. They're still having a really hard time wrapping their minds around the idea that Jesus is the Messiah, but the Messiah doesn't look like, you know, what everybody calls greatness, wealth and power and success and glamour and celebrity, that Jesus has come to be the opposite of those things exactly because he's the Messiah. So he tells it to him again. And when that confounds them, our blessed narrator helpfully says, and the disciples didn't know what he was saying, and they didn't even want to ask. Then Jesus changes the subject, sort of poke things a little further. And when they finally landed at the town they're going to stay in for a while, he says, hey, what were you guys all arguing about on the way? Jesus knows, right? It's not like there's music in the car that's been so loud he can't overhear the conversation. He knows exactly what they've been arguing about. They've been all fighting about who's greatest, because they're playing the same old game. They're all playing the same game of who's the most important person, because who's closest to Jesus, or what other great people have they been around. It's still burning closer in the elevator thinking. And so Jesus has to redefine not just what the word Messiah means, that's sort of a technical religious term. Jesus has to redefine what greatness looks like. And he says, y'all been thinking about it wrong. Greatness isn't who's the most important person who's been in an elevator that everybody would recognize as a celebrity alongside you. Jesus says, if you want to be great in this kind of community, in my kind of community, in the reign of God, you put yourself in the last place and look for who you can help out. You look for who you serve. If you want to be first, you put yourself in last place. If you want to be great, look for a way to serve the people everybody else has overlooked. That's what our kind of greatness looks like. It blows apart their lifelong expectations, not only about what God and God's appointed Messiah would do, but what they're supposed to do if they're going to follow this Jesus whom they call Messiah. And then, as if to drive the point home, Jesus borrows someone's child. They're clearly at somebody's house or something like that. And Jesus sort of takes this toddler, preschool kid in their midst and sets this child in their midst and says, in fact, whoever welcomes a child like this in my name welcomes me. In fact, welcomes the one who sent me. Now, we probably need to take a holy time out about what it means that Jesus brings a child into their midst, because we in our culture have a whole different set of cultural baggage and assumptions about what children mean compared to what the ancient Near East and people in the Greek and Roman Empire thought. In our culture, pretty much, we're all pro-children. Right? Yeah, children are cute, and they're innocent, and they're adorable, and they're lovely, and they're just so gosh darn cute, and they say the darndest thing, so we have this, like, children are for, it's very, very important. Listen to any public discussion or public comment period or public debate and watch how anybody can try and be persuasive with, won't somebody think of the children, right? In our culture, of course, children are very, very important. In the culture in which Jesus lives, children are barely considered people. Because young children can't get you anything, can't earn anything, don't have any status, don't have the ability to earn money, don't have citizenship. In Jesus' culture, in the Greek and Roman Empire, children aren't important except for the possibility one day they can grow up, you know, into useful human beings. Because basically, let's be honest, let's get rid of the sort of saccharine sweetness here. Young children are needy. Right? Real young kids, they don't contribute to the family economy, right? They certainly don't make any money to bring an income into the family. They can't even set the table when they're real, real young, right? Pretty much it's all neediness. And they're people who's basically treated like their opinion doesn't count. Jesus sets a child into their midst, not because he's trying to be cute or relish the innocence of childhood, but to say, here's somebody who brings nothing to the table. Receive this person as you would receive me. Because in the kingdom of God, we aren't concerned with what favors can I get in return, or what is this person going to do for me in return for accepting them. In the kingdom of God, we treat everybody like a child in the family rather than an employee or someone who can do a deal with you. That's the radical difference Jesus brings. To say that God's kingdom isn't about deal-making and you only be nice to people who will do something nice to you in return for what they could get you or what access they might grant you or favors they could do for you in the future. No, in the kingdom of God, we treat one another like children in a family. And your belonging in a family does not depend on what you bring in. It doesn't depend on how well you set the table or how well you do your chores. We'd love it if you do your chores. Your parents loved it when you were able to set the table or put your clothes away or whatever. But your belonging doesn't hinge on it. Your belonging comes by grace. Jesus, even from this beginning moment in his community of disciples, says, we're going to do things differently. We will treat people as though they belong not because of what they can do for us or how the world regards them as great or important and therefore they've earned a spot. Everybody brings the very presence of God into your midst. What if you treated people, everybody you meet, as though they are worthy of that kind of welcome, not because of what they can do for you, or what they bring to the table, or their possible future usefulness in granting you favors, but simply because the party wouldn't be the same without them there? That's radical, but that's the beautiful gift of us being the followers of Jesus, that we're gathered into a community that doesn't depend on what do I bring to the table to earn my way in, or to earn my keep to stay in, but to hear that I'm beloved just as I am. That changes things, friends. In fact, it will do three things that I can think of immediately to the way we face this day. Number one, if I take Jesus' word seriously, and I highly recommend taking Jesus seriously, if I take Jesus' word seriously, that our belonging is like children in a family, not employees or contract people in a business situation, that it means I'm beloved even on the days it feels like I don't contribute very much. There are days when each of us does an awful lot and we feel like, well, I've earned my keep for the day. That is a losing game because every so often there come around those days when it feels like I don't bring much to the table, right? It is awfully easy to feel like people's worth in a household, in a community, in a society only depend on how much are you making, how much money do you bring in, how many hours of help do you contribute, and it can feel like, if I'm not in a position to help contribute right now, or I can't work right now, or if I can't bring in, or I don't have the energy right now, do I not belong anymore? Man, is it easy to fall into that same old mode of thinking. Jesus says, in the community we call church, in the kingdom of God, that's not how it works. Your belonging is because you're a child of God, not because there's going to be a return on the investment of letting you into a club. There is no club. And if I can see that in children who bring to the table not even the ability to do chores, much less bring in an income into the family, then I can see even on my worst days, even on the days it feels like I've got nothing to offer, but I'm still beloved, I still belong. That changes in the moment of I'm most worried about, am I acceptable still, even when I'm having an off day, or an off week, or an off month. The second thing it will do for us is it changes the way we recognize Jesus in other people. In fact, it changes every other interaction. Notice the way Jesus says when he takes his child into his midst and says, when you receive somebody like this, someone who's empty-handed, who doesn't bring anything else, who can't do anything for your return, it's like you're receiving me. In fact, it's like receiving the God who sent me. And that means every interaction you and I have has the potential of being seen as doing it in the very presence of God. So Jesus isn't saying, when he brings a child, he's not saying, you should love people who are young, but once I reach 12, stop caring about them. Jesus' point is to say, here's somebody who can't do anything for you in return. I'm calling you, welcome these people, and then of course you'll do things for the people who can do favors. Were you sure? Think about the way our interactions are changed. When you volunteer and help bring a meal for the families that are without housing at Family Promise, what a difference it makes. Instead of just here, dropping off a student and leaving, but to share a table and discover these are people who bring the very presence of God into my life. That changes things. It is so easy to treat other people like sort of pitying them or condescendingly. You poor slobs, you need my help, I'm here to save the day. But to show up at a table and say, here, I brought spaghetti, and share a table with them and discover God's presence in and with them as well. That changes the interaction. or the bracelet project we've been working on to raise money for Afghan refugees who needed to escape when things fell apart in Afghanistan, those who've been our allies. These are people who will not ever pay us back for the donation you made for a metal bracelet in church once. But the goal isn't, how can I do something good that one day I'll get paid back for? But in the kingdom of God, we're called to be gracious to folks who will never be able to pay us back, because that's not how God's kingdom works. It's like a family where we all take care of each other. And some days, some folks don't bring anything to the table, and yet they're beloved. And I lean on that too when I'm the one who feels like I don't bring anything to the table too. Every interaction is changed. That means too, that you don't have to wait for some particular moment to have an encounter with God. But the person in front of you in the grocery store is taken forever with their basket full of stuff that you wish they'd hurry up. Guess what? Presence of God. There is the possibility of encountering God in that moment. How would it change your interaction with the person you want to be cranky toward if you discover, wait a second, if I receive them like I receive a child who can't do anything for me, maybe even they could be the presence of God for me. That changes it. The person you want to be snarky or mean to on social media or in the parking lot somewhere, we have the opportunity to see this as an encounter with no less than the living God that changes those interactions. Every person you encounter then can be somebody who brings the presence of God along, and they might just tell the story the same way. They might go home and tell their family, I've encountered somebody who brought the face of God to me, and you will be the center of their story because you brought God's presence to them as well. That changes things. That makes every place you go holy ground. My goodness. The third thing that means for us, not just assurance for me that I'm accepted apart from what I've done or earned, and two, seeing every interaction as the presence of Christ in my midst. The third thing it does is it changes how you answer the question, who's the greatest person you ever shared a room with? Like I said, in my own lifetime, the answer to that question has changed, depending on where I'm at or what seems to be super important. And like I said, once upon a time, a 1980s Cleveland football star was my answer, the most important person I've ever been in a room with, or a person who wrote hymns that we occasionally sometimes sing. Now my answer's changed. It's not even somebody who followed me on social media. These days, if I'm honest, if I've been listening to the teachings of Jesus, these days when I ask myself who's the most important person, who's the greatest person I've ever been in the same room with, I have to open my eyes and say, whoever God has sent across my path in this very moment brings me no less than the presence of Jesus. Which means, in this moment, I'm graced by the presence of Jesus in all of you. And when I leave this place, I'll be blessed with the presence of Jesus and all the strangers I will encounter there, and you have that possibility as well. Every encounter just might be the greatest encounter, the most important person you'll ever meet, because it's Jesus who's showing up there. How would it change how you face this week to consider every interaction as a chance to meet Jesus face to face? And maybe, as the other person tells the story, for you to be the presence of Jesus for them too. The way you answer that question, who's the greatest person you've ever been in the same room with, says an awful lot about who you assume is really great. Jesus dares us to find his presence in the people everybody else says don't matter because they don't bring anything to the table. You and I know differently. Every person you encounter can be treated as a child of God belonging in the family, not because of what they earn, but because the party wouldn't be the same without them, just like the party wouldn't be the same without you. You'll meet Jesus this week, sisters and brothers. You'll be the face of Jesus at the same time. Amen. We rise as we're able to sing our hymn of the day, number 595, Jesus Loves Me.
Thank you.
Apostles' Creed, found on page 105 or in the back of our hymnals. I believe in God,
Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and then he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
We lift our prayers today with a response. Hear our prayer. Made children and heirs of God's promise, we pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. God of community, we pray for the church around the world. Unite us in our love for you. Help us overcome our divisions, that we are encouraged to work together for your sake. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of creation, we pray for this hurting earth. Awaken in us a new desire to care for this world and empower us to support agencies, organizations, and individual efforts to heal our environment from all damage done by humankind. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of cooperation, we pray for nations of the world embroiled in conflict. Inspire leaders to listen to each other and work towards peaceful solutions to disagreements. Protect the vulnerable, especially children, who cannot find safety in their home or their countries. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of comfort, we pray for all who live with mental or physical illness. Help them find appropriate care. Bring healing and wholeness when the path forward seems most bleak. Let us pray especially for TJ and Sarah, for Barb, for the Borman family and the Shaw family, for Marcy, for Bev, for Barb, and for Bonnie. We pray for our own needs and for those of others, aloud with our voices or silently in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of compassion, we pray for the young people of this congregation. Renew in us your call to welcome the children in our midst. As they grow, strengthen their faith and our commitment to them. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of consolation, we give you thanks for our loved ones who have died and pray for all who grieve today. Shine your grace on all your saints. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of living water, we continue to pray for our nation and for the world as we face continuing uncertainties around public health and socio-political issues. Protect the most vulnerable among us and grant us wisdom, patience, and clarity to healthcare workers, frontline workers, and educators, especially as their work caring for others puts them at continued risk. Guide us as we continue to consider how best to prepare and respond in our families, our congregations, our workplaces, and our communities. Continue to give us courage to face these days not with fear, but with compassion, concern, and acts of service, trusting that you abide with us always. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And into your ever-loving and gracious hands, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your steadfast mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. We're invited to share a sign of Christ's peace with one another, and then we'll sing our offertory number 692, We Are in the World. Forgiveness of sin, do this for the remembrance of me. remembering then his love for us on the way, at the table, and to the end, we pray the words Jesus gave us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God, and you are welcome at Jesus' table. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Almighty God, you provide the true bread from heaven, your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Grant that we who have received the sacrament of his body and blood may abide in him and he in us, that we may be filled with the power of his endless life, now and forever.
Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
We sing as our sending hymn number 551, The Spirit Sends Us Forth to Serve.